In the previous course, we learned that the transaction object has a section called rules, in which we define the controls that must be made or the rules that must be fulfilled for a certain reality. We focused on the error rule, which prevents a record from being stored in the database while a certain condition is met. For example, if we're entering a client and leave his or her name empty, that client cannot be inserted until the user has typed in a name. We also saw the message rule, which only informs the user through a message, but allows saving. The default rule, which allows us to initialize an attribute or variable with a value when we access the transaction in insert mode. The no accept rule, which prevents the user from making changes to a field in the form. It shows it disabled. And finally, the serial rule, which is used to auto-number a second, third, or other nested level of a transaction. We also learned that through the rules, we can define value assignments or invoke objects, and that we can also condition them to be executed only when we're making additions, modifications, or deletions. In addition, if the moment chosen by GeneXus to execute a rule is not the one we need, we can indicate the exact moment we want it to be executed using triggering events. Remember that all these rules we've studied are validated both in the web client and in the server. The validation that occurs in the client is called client-side validation, and its purpose is to provide a good user experience, making the user feel that the application is interacting with him all the time. But actually, the server validates that all the information sent is consistent and does not breach the security of the system. And it's the only one that can operate on the database. So far, we've seen the default behavior of these rules. But we need to know that there's a group of properties called client-side validation behavior, and it's available at the version level, which allows us to customize the behavior and messages of the rules in many ways, making the application more attractive to end users. When we used the error rule, we saw that although the transaction doesn't allow saving, it does allow moving to the next field after showing the error message. If we want to keep the focus on the control and require the user to correct the value in order to move to the next field when an error is triggered, we must change the value of the stop on error property to yes. We can also define the position of the message in relation to the field using the validation message position property, which has the values right, which is the default value, left, top, and bottom. If the message is overlapped with another control, the validation message overlap adjacent controls property must also be set, which controls whether the messages should overlap or not. The last property of the group is validation message display, which has the values one at a time, which is the default value, and whose objective is to always show the last validation message activated by the application. And all at once, which displays every validation message that should be on the screen at the same time. Since these properties change the behavior related to the interaction in the forms, all the objects that have a form must be generated again for the changes to be made. To do this, you must use the rebuild all option, which generates absolutely all objects. In the following video, we'll add some interesting rules to those we already know, and in others, we'll explore how they're evaluated to determine the order of execution, as well as to take a closer look at the triggering events.